and you see like a sea of punk rockers in front of you, and you just say, "Fuck it, is this real?" Yeah, because I'm doing other things, and Mike is, and the other guys. I like to see that movement come back, like fabulous.
Did you, as a band, get ripped off at all? And
or yeah, we got ripped off, but that's just experience. It's like an apprenticeship. You know, you learn. You learn by your mistakes. If your mum says, "Don't touch the oven," and she says it every day, until you actually touch the oven, you won't stop. You know, it's animal. It's the animal part of everything else. You know, you just got to be like that. You got to screwed a little bit in the business, but you know, don't get screwed too much. That's what it's down to.
Well, who would have thought 20 years later, I'm still around?
I'm
How much money did you get off Decca?
We got 150 Gs.
Really?
Yeah.
That much?
Yeah.
What did you do with it?
KLM Airlines, a weekend in Holland, and all that kind of crap, you know. Mm. We had a good time. We invested it in the album as well, the Do It Dog Style album. A lot went on that. A lot went into the touring, publicity, piano, and all that. You know, that's where it all went.
Sex. Went.
Quick. So, can you tell me about your personal outlook on life and how it changed once you got involved with the band?
Well, nothing really changed because until we went down to live in London, because we stayed for around about a year. When we signed to Decca, around about a year, we stayed in Manchester still because our roots were there. But like a year after, we had to go back down to London because like everything was happening there, and like getting the telephone, speaking to somebody, it's like, how much is the bill, Mum? And £100 this time, £200 next month, And that way, it was like that, so we just went down to live there. And then it became a business. And, the business side of it kind of pissed me off because there was no more fun. Everything was becoming stress, You're waiting for this all the time. And you can't do this without seeing this person. And like that, it's just like, that's not a rock band. Rock band is fun, a punk band's fun, a reggae band is fun. Just let them do what they want to do, right? They'll create art purely, and the commercial side will come to it later on. The business guys can look after that afterwards. But you can let bands do what they want to do. The problem today is, you got all this kind of shitty stuff like Oasis or crap like that, which are just pumping out exactly what was going on years and years ago. But before they're doing it, they're asking how many records they're going to sell.
So do you think the men are businessmen now, bands? To be successful, you've got to be businessmen.
I don't think they're good businessmen. I think they have good businessmen who work very good with them. That's what it's down to. I think the only good businessman in the music business, well, the two, that's Prince and Springsteen, because they control everything, They still have the ball and everything in their favour, so that's okay with what they're doing. But I mean, the rest of the bands, basically, they just think they know what they're doing, and somebody's screwing them behind.
Why go? Who be the one? Why? Can I start it off?
They lost 4-0.
We didn't go out there to play punk rock, it just happened like that, you know. I mean, David had Pistols, I think it was. I think, personally speaking, the Pistols, they weren't punk. I don't think the Clash were either. I don't think we were. I think the punk generation came from the second generation. You know, like the Exploited, the, you know, GBH and things like that. That was real. That was gruesome.
How did you feel about that?
What, about the second generation?
Yeah.
Right.
We'll be right back.
Alright, so by 78, the music press had pronounced punk dead, and yet it was still going on underground. How did you feel about the way the media treated it?
Well, I felt pretty shit, actually, because, like, when you get interviews and, like, when you get press cuttings, and, like, they were just kind of pro-Cockney, pro-London, and they hated any kind of group what came from Manchester. I mean, it's terrible. I mean, the Jaws, they got shit reviews. We did as well. The Buzzcocks, they got killed, apart from when Howard split and Peter went down to work a lot in London, and he was accepted. We went down there and we were just kind of, oh, you know, you're all right, lad. Who's these kind of guys? You know, they thought we came from Stonehenge, on the planet. And that was, that pissed me off a little bit. But that's, you know, that's the music business in London. Everything's hype and la-di-da. And you can't fart, you know. You can't do what you want. I mean, when I remember the things that happened in interviews, they come out with things like, what do, you know, this, so this means this, then does it? And I'd be like that. And one of the songs, no. They were trying to find, you know, ways of destroying what we used to write and kind of pervert it and use it for kind of movements, you know, political movements, because they just wanted to get on the ball and say, oh, it's us what started that kind of thing off. No. So that pissed me off a lot.
It's many different versions, myths and tales of how and where punk came from. Which one do you believe?
Punk happened. That's basically it. It happened. There's no real story about punk. I mean, every punk band says we invented punk. You know, that's crap. It's crap. I mean, if we listen to, you know, you've got to listen to Woody Guthrie. He invented punk. If you look under the word punk, what it means in a dictionary, right? That's exactly what Woody Guthrie was doing. He was doing punk music, only they labelled it kind of country, traditional American music. That's like, nobody invented it. It just happened.
Oh, it's a mystery girl.
But if we move on to a couple of your songs, tell me where have all the boot boys gone?
Where did
the inspiration for that come from?
Manchester United. Man United. Basically, like, I used to hang out with a mob in Withenshaw, and we used to go to all the Manchester United matches. And this was the skinhead movement, which was the boot boy movement. Beginning, the two-tone thing. And it was just like, I looked at the King's song, where has all the boot tones gone, and all that kind of stuff. And I said, it'd be fun to kind of do a song about what I used to experience in football matches. Because that was the skin movement was a great movement at the beginning. It just got perverted once again. And the guys just fell into a couple of kind of crazy cliches, politically speaking.
This song is dedicated to Fenn, who is most probably the best fan of football who lives in Scotland. He can't be here tonight because he's a little bit sick, but it's only in his head, he's going to get better. And we love you, we're thinking of you, and this song is special for you.
Where have all the boot boys gone?
Slot was never, for us personally, we were never a kind of political movement band. The only politics that we had was, let's stop the kids from smashing cars up, stealing them, and all that kind of thing. You know, like an hour and a quarter of Slaughter in 77 was a real, it was a sauna. And the kids used to come out of the gigs. I remember seeing them come out, and they were like, wham, on the floor, and they were, you're right, mate. You're okay, yeah, I'm all right, you know. They won't go out stealing, you know, fucking things up and all that.
I was going to be very negative about it. I could say this entire thing was just a nostalgia trip for a lot of bands. I mean, how would you react?
When Mike called me up, and he said that he wanted to do this thing, would I be okay with doing it? I was kind of reluctant in wanting to do it for one reason, is we didn't do the 10-year thing, because there was the 10-year movement, and I was into other fields of music, I was doing a lot of stuff, and it was too fresh, it was too soon. I had too much kind of bitterness and bitter memories, what happened, and it was too fresh. Now with 20 years on, I mean, all the bitter memories have just completely disappeared. I lived in Withenshaw when I was a kid. My destiny was three things. It was Donald, Robin, or football or music. So I had the choice, one of the three, and I chose the third one, footballer. That's not true. I chose the music, and Mike did the same, because Mike, there's a lot of work. Poverty, hanging around places like Withenshaw, it's like blotting paper, just kind of draws you in, and if you don't kind of do something about it before you know, you're out of it, and nothing's, how old am I? I'm 60, what have I done in my life? Paul's old. I say to kids, do what you want, move your ass. Don't kind of go into that kind of system. No, systems and movements, right, are okay, but don't be comfortable in what you have. Go look for something else. There's loads of things you can do in life.
Yeah.
punk mean? Punk means be yourself. Be your fucking self. That's what it means. You know, do what you want.
As long as you make boot boys, beat yourself.
Yeah, beat yourself up. You know, no. Just do what you have to do. As long as you don't make anybody else shit. That's
the basic. Do you get any sun where you live?
No, I don't actually. I'm a big hider of the sun. I hate the sun.
I do.
I live in a hot place, but I hate the sun. Because this is a holiday, isn't it, Sean?
Okay, weirdos. Sing to Jesus.